Our next speaker is an experimental psychologist at the University of Oxford. Her early research explored human social decision-making. Her more recent work has focused on mental health disorders, including bipolar and borderline personality disorders, with the hope of delivering a new and better intervention to help people manage mood instability. In 2011, Amy started working with colleagues at Oxford to conduct a groundbreaking study into the effects of yoga and meditation on UK prisoners, later publishing evidence suggesting that these practices can improve mental well-being in incarcerated individuals and help foster better patterns of decision-making. She is a vipassana meditator and a yogi, and hopes to continue exploring the potential for yoga, meditation, and mindfulness practices in her future research. Today, she's going to speak about some of the recent insights from the world of neuroscience into how mindfulness and meditation might work in the brain. In particular, she will discuss how these practices might ultimately influence our behaviour, including the ethical choices that we make. Please welcome Dr. Amy Bilderbeck.
Good evening, everyone. Let me start by saying how amazing an evening it has been for me, and I'm sure it has been for you too. This is my first time in Coventry, and what an amazing way to get to know this city. Thank you so much, Matt, for your kind introduction. Thank you, Dav, Pushy, and the others with the team, The Flame, for inviting me to speak today. And thank you all for coming. It's a real pleasure to be here, an honor to hear other people speaking about what it is that meditation and mindfulness has done for them, how it's helped them to find new grounding, new openings, and new understandings from these practices. I feel very humbled to follow these speakers tonight. They have so eloquently described the potential of mindfulness and other meditative practices. So as Matt said, what I hope to do is describe some of the psychology and neuroscience research that seems to explore and try to understand what it is that meditation and mindfulness does for us, what it does to us indeed. And as Matt said, I should mention that my ideas are very much influenced by my experiences of practicing yoga and vipassana meditation. That includes using mindfulness to manage chronic back pain that I started experiencing in my mid-20s. That's just one of the ways that the practices have seemed to have been important in my own life. Okay, because meditation is so exciting and such a promising topic of research, there are more and more people who want to work in this area. Meditation research is probably enjoying its heyday. What many researchers in this field of study feel is that what meditation and mindfulness does for us, in part at least, is to alter our cognitive capacity, our ability to regulate emotions, and the way that we feel empathy. Now, that might all sound rather clinical and scientific mumbo-jumbo. I will try to excuse that approach towards the end of my talk, forgive me. So when I say that meditation increases our cognitive capacity, I mean that people who start meditating as part of the experiment, or perhaps those of you who have been meditating for some time, it seems to be that they are better in tasks where they need to sustain their attention, or use their memory, or plan, or concentrate on a task, which we as experimenters have tried to make difficult by presenting some distracting information which is irrelevant. Part of my own research has suggested that yoga and meditation do indeed improve cognitive capacity. So we were working with UK prisoners, and we randomly assigned some of them to a group to do yoga and meditation, and the others we asked to not do yoga and meditation, continue with their daily lives within the prisons. The meditation courses were 10 weeks long, and there was only one class per week, so not a highly intensive practice, we can say. At the end of the course, we asked the participants to complete a computer task, where they had to press a button quickly every time they saw an X flash up on the computer screen, which we put in front of them, but to not press the button when they saw an O flash up on the screen. What a crazy task, you might think. It's a classic psychology task called the go-no-go task. And it sounds kind of easy, perhaps, but people do make mistakes, because the game goes quite fast, and you're under pressure to respond as quickly and as accurately as possible. Now, we call this a game, but it's not really a game. It probably sounds very boring, right? And it is boring. that's part of the design, perhaps. What we found was that participants who had done the yoga and the meditation did better in this task than those who hadn't done the yoga. And it looked like they did better across the whole task. They weren't better at responding to the X's or not responding to the O's. They were better across both, in a way that suggested to us that the yoga practice and the meditation had helped them to sustain their attention through the task. Or possibly, it increased their threshold for boredom. But both sound like rather useful new skills to me. We also importantly found that doing the yoga and the meditation seemed to improve their mood and decrease levels of stress and other psychological problems. So this, in other words, suggests that meditation can improve some of the basic building blocks of our cognitive processes. That includes memory, attention, and our abilities to deal appropriately with emotional information. For example, meditation is associated with reduced physiological responses to unpleasant pictures, which is another thing that psychologists sometimes do to you in our experiments. And it also helps us deal better with doing a task if some unpleasant pictures are being shown to us at the same time. We can manage to stay on the task more effectively. What all this seems to result in is improved decision making in both social and non-social contexts. Personally, I find the impact of meditation on social decision making to be particularly fascinating. Social decisions, of course, are the ones that we make with other people or the ones that might influence other people. Our way of relating to each other is incredibly important for our happiness and our well-being, as I'm sure most, if not everyone here, can appreciate. So this is an important aspect of our psychology. It's also important in terms of ethics. The social decisions that we make almost always have something to do with our personal moral codes. And this has a knock-on effect on the societies in which we live and the dynamics within those societies. So now we can perhaps start thinking about the brain itself and what neuroscience has started to show us about decision-making in the brain. One idea that's been around for a while now is that there are, very broadly speaking, two modes of processing in the brain. The first one is fast and automatic, and is more often linked to our emotions. The second is more controlled, intentional, and slower. This idea is expanded on and defended in a recent book that some of you may have heard of or even read, called Thinking Fast and Slow by Daniel Kahneman. So why two processes? Well, this probably helps us make decisions with a good balance between speed and processing power. Sometimes, quite often in fact, we need to make decisions quickly. Think about how stereotypically and quickly you might deal with something which feels fearful, seeing a spider, seeing a snake, or an oncoming car. So being able to respond quickly saves us time, it often may save lives, and it's also energy efficient. The brain uses a lot of calories, so making decisions quickly can be a benefit there too. But it seems that this first system, the automatic one, is also more prone to making systematic mistakes or errors. We can think of that as bias. So there's a trade-off for its speed. Then there is the second system. We might use that system when we need to take more factors into account about our decisions or plan more systematically. And that system seems to be less prone to bias and less affected by our emotions at the time we make the decision. You can see these two systems in opposition sometimes. Think about the inner conflict that might occur when a fresh-baked chocolate chip cookie is in front of someone who is trying to eat more healthily. Mode 1 and Mode 2 are saying very different things, right? And we think we can observe these two modes of processing playing out in the brain, using different brain imaging techniques. A rather large body of work suggests that that first mode is involved with limbic regions in the brain, subcortical regions which are buried deeply in our brains. That second system, the slower one, seems to be more associated with the prefrontal cortex. The prefrontal cortex is the part behind your forehead and up above the eyes. Interestingly, long-term meditators in some studies seem to have greater cortical thickness or greater gray matter density in that prefrontal cortex. So this begins to give us a hint of the kinds of psychological or behavioral changes that we might expect after meditation. So let's come back to social behavior. A number of studies have shown us that meditation can influence our social behavior, and perhaps it won't be surprising to this audience, it seems that meditating can make us more pro-social, including more cooperative, more likely to help others, and more sharing. In one clever study, some participants who were asked to do a meditation course for 8 weeks were more likely to give up their seat to a person with physical disabilities. It was a setup within the experiment, and you can compare between groups. In another study, participants who had completed a short course of compassion meditation were more likely to give money to another person, another victim, who had been the victim of unfair behavior. Activity was also altered in the brain there, including in that prefrontal cortex area that I mentioned. Other studies have painted a picture whereby meditation can help us regulate negative emotions, cultivate compassion during decision making. And some of this work also suggests that the way we process rewards, and perhaps the kinds of rewards that we gain from social encounters, changes after meditation. For example, in another experiment, meditation increased the amount of money that people would freely give to another person. They don't have no incentive, they're not going to be punished if they don't give, but they give more. And sometimes we also see more activity in areas of the brain associated with reward when they give money. Usually certain parts of the brain become more active when we receive money, like if we are gambling and we get a win. But those areas of the brain also seem to light up in brain imaging experiments when we are giving money away to someone and helping them. So all this seems to suggest that meditation can promote good decision making and reduce decision bias and improve even altruistic and pro-social behaviors. In addition, some of this work suggests that meditation increases empathy, so the ability to understand what others are experiencing. So in another study, compassion meditators were shown photographs of people's eyes, so only this area of the face, and they were found to be better at being able to guess the mood state of that person just from looking at the eyes. You might say that they seem to be better at understanding other people given very limited information about them. Okay, so I will try to draw all this together. What I and others have speculated is that meditation can help people to make decisions in a more reflective mode, recruiting more of that second, slower, and perhaps more impartial, less biased pathway, acting in fuller consideration of their values and objectives, and also somewhere along the way experiencing or using more empathy. So perhaps part of meditation helps us to act more consistently in line with a personal ethical code. Do I value fairness? Do I value generosity? And can I feel feelings of self-righteousness, irritability, and so on, without denying or judging them, but balancing the demands of those emotions with a less emotional perspective? Can I avert some habitual behavior, such as making an impulsive choice or ruminating like I always do, and instead consider trying something else instead? So maybe this is just one way of thinking about what happens when we meditate. But there's much that remains unclear and unknown, and I would like to just mention a few of those things. Firstly, there is not a great deal of research that's been conducted on meditation yet. And many of these studies are small, with only perhaps 20 people in them. They often ask people to do different kinds of meditation. As I'm sure some of you know, there are many different kinds of ways of practicing mindfulness, ways of meditating, and so on. So we can't always compare across these studies or know what the key elements are. And researchers often have different ways of interpreting it and focusing on their data. And it will take time before we can feel confident about how reliable these data are, and before there's more coherence with the way that we explain our data. In terms of brain imaging, we neuroscientists often struggle with the complexity of the brain. For example, there does not appear to be an empathy center that we can put our finger on, point our finger at, or hover our cursor over. Different parts of the brain seem to work together in some strange, inscrutable dance. We might think of the prefrontal cortex as a choreographer of that dance, but even this part of the brain by itself is very large and very complex. So this problem continues to be a struggle for brain imaging researchers like myself. I'll make one final comment. Research on mindfulness has so far, to a large extent, piggybacked on previous psychology research. For example, taking ideas from previous research about those two modes of thinking that I mentioned, fast and slow. But meditation research might well make important contributions that are unique about human thought and experience, aspects that we've hardly started to think about within biomedical research. The example I'd like to give is the experience of awe, by which I mean reverential feelings of wonder. Awe seems to be related to fascinating changes in the way that we perceive ourselves, or our self, with a capital S. In one very recent study, the experience of awe predicted more generous behavior in a simple economic game. Indeed, it predicted generous behavior better than pro-social emotions like compassion, which is a bit surprising and suggests that awe is a very powerful experience indeed. Furthermore, it looked like the way that awe seemed to influence generosity was by making the self feel small. That might not sound terribly good at first, and perhaps I haven't put it eloquently enough, but it seems to me that we might expect more exciting research on how meditation might influence our experience of life and others in our behavior by helping us situate ourselves within a broader social, societal, and ecological context beyond the bubble of our own immediate lives. This is something I think Dav might, I think, call letting go of the ego. Okay, I started my talk indicating that I felt humbled following the speakers earlier this evening, and I do. I'll finish by saying that I'm humbled because oftentimes when we are actually meditating, the personal lived experience is everything. We do not necessarily need to employ a researcher or read an article in a science magazine in order to know that mindfulness and meditation benefit us. This research probably cannot capture fully the personal experience of these practices. But I hope the research can also be of value. It can strengthen our motivation or renew our interest, give us new ways of seeing things about our practice. It might encourage people who haven't tried to give it a go. It can be used as evidence for healthcare providers, for new applications within our medical health systems, and it can help rally funding. Research can also establish whether for certain individuals, meditation is not in fact recommended or should be considered together with other therapeutic strategies or with the support of professionals. Overarchingly, researchers like me hope that our work might be able to make a unique contribution to understanding the nature of the brain and the mind and the human experience. I hope you feel encouraged in your practice or inspired to learn more. Thank you for your time this evening.